Macmillan Audio presents Alice Payne Rides by Kate Heartfield. Narrated for you by Jennywren Walker. For my parents, who taught me to work for a better timeline. Chapter 1. By which a hostess's intentions are made plain. 1789. Alice Payne's dinner party fractures in the dessert course. She can almost see a fissure split the gleaming walnut of her new table, running between the plate of lemon cakes and the bowl of macaroons and veering catter-corner to the custards. The footman, a glorious sensation to have a footman at Fleance Hall, pours for each guest, and Alice sees that they have chosen their factions. Some drink port and talk politics, Alice herself, and Prudence Zuniga, the newest resident of Fleance Hall. Catherine Jenner, the youngest member of the party at 28 years old, who has just come out of her first confinement. And at the far end of the table, next to Jane, Ambrose Duncan, the painter. Some drink tea and talk science. Her beloved Jane, of course. Gertrude Lighton, 70 years old if she's a day, who has recently won a 34-year inheritance lawsuit and can finally claim to own the house in which she lives with Agnes Bell. And Miss Bell, ostensibly Miss Lighton's companion, in much the same way that Jane is ostensibly Alice's companion. And the final tea drinker is Edward Jenner, country doctor and polymath, married to Catherine. But how can we be sure that the king has recovered? Catherine Jenner asks. Mr. Duncan seems to assume that the question was directed at him, or at least that his opinion is the most germane.
We never can be sure, but so long as His Majesty remains able to perform at least some of the functions of his office, all our Whig hopes for democratic reform must be tempered, Mr. Duncan says and sighs, swirling the port in his glass.
But what must that mean for the anti-slavery movement?
Mrs. Jenner continues, and all of the white-skinned people at the table very studiously do not look at Prudence Zuniga in that moment. It's a curious development. Alice, whose own mother was enslaved, is used to being the subject of averted gazes. But Prudence, being darker complected than Alice, being a stranger to Hampshire, has spun some invisible social orrery, changing all the angles of the glances.
Nothing good, I'm afraid, says Prudence, with a little twitch at the corner of her mouth.
Alice's quizzical glance draws nothing more from Prudence, as usual. Prudence will seldom be drawn on the subject of the future. She protests that the future does not exist, that there are many possible futures, and that the future whence she came very likely no longer exists. Still, she sometimes gets a knowing look in her eyes that is irritating in the extreme, in combination with her reticence. At the same moment as Catherine Jenner asks about the king, her husband, Edward Jenner, leans toward Jane and asks,
But how can you be sure that the light itself was the cause of the needle's action?
The experiment must be repeated, of course, Jane says with a slight flush to her cheek that Alice recognizes well. But I have thought at great length about the affinity that underlies light and magnetism and electricity.
You see some sort of occult connection? Miss Lighton asks eagerly.
Well, I wouldn't put it quite that way, says Jane, but I do think...
My mentor always says a man of science should never think, but only do, says Dr. Jenner. It is only through repeated examinations of the interior workings of the cuckoo, you see, that I was able to gain entrance to the Royal Society, and that only just this year. It takes many years of hard work to get anywhere in science, Miss Hodgson.
Jane sips her tea.
The Royal Society has made it quite clear that I shall not gain entry, Dr. Jenner, no matter how many birds I cut open.
Of course, he says, slightly flustered. Well, never mind about them, my dear. I only mean to say that reason must always be handmaiden to observation. I have learned a great deal by observing the simple country people. But if I am to convince the esteemed gentlemen in London of the truth of anything, I must gather evidence. They have yet to be convinced, for example, that a bout of cowpox in childhood can confer immunity to smallpox. But I have seen...
Captain Auden will be heartbroken to have missed this, Prudence whispers, leaning toward Alice, so only she will hear, under the din of the two larger simultaneous conversations.
Ha! Alice whispers back with a smile. I think all this so-called investigating is a neat excuse. After all, we know he could be here at any time he likes. What is he off investigating today? The prince is in the tower again.
Arthur of Brittany, Prudence says.
Dr. Jenner, are you on about the cowpox again?
Mr. Duncan says too loudly, and the table goes silent. Mr. Duncan is florid now, on his fourth glass.
Forgive me, says Dr. Jenner, inclining his head. My wife says that once I get in a rut, it would take a Clydesdale team to pull me out.
He says my wife, in a way that makes it clear the phrase has all the luster of newness still to him, and he takes her hand.
It occurs to me that I have not congratulated you on the birth of your son, Jenner, Mr. Duncan continues. A new subject for your experiments.
Not if I can help it, Catherine says with a bright smile.
A wife is a wonderful thing,
Mr. Duncan goes on as if no one had spoken.
A wonderful thing, the savior of a man, I always say. Otherwise, the passions of men miscarry in the most destructive ways.
You make the passions of men sound rather horrible, Mr. Duncan, says Alice. She takes a few confits, like tiny white pearls of rice, from her plate with a silver spoon. The sugared seeds brighten her tongue, benumb it just a little, as the earthy warmth of the caraway spreads through her mouth. She gently works the seeds between two molars, which helps her to say nothing for the moment. She glances at the two old ladies, who seem likely to destroy Mr. Duncan simply by staring beatifically at him.
Oh, of course, I should not speak of such things to maiden ladies,
the painter says, redder and louder now.
Women cannot understand it, of course.
You think we are not capable of love, then, Mr. Duncan? Miss Lytton asks, with a smile of glorious indifference.
Oh, you mistake me. Why, Miss Lytton, you and Miss Bell are examples of the kind of love that comes naturally to women, a chaste love.
Alice and Jane catch each other, keeping their mouths from twisting into giggles. But the two old ladies, who have shared the same household since George II was on the throne, simply stare at Mr. Duncan, their faces inscrutable.
I have heard it said, Alice says, examining the port in her glass as if scrying, that not all love between ladies is entirely chaste.
She doesn't need to look to the end of the table to know that Jane's fair face has gone pink. Alice delights in showing Jane how little she cares about the opinion of the world. And why should she care now? Now that she has paid off father's creditors and Fleance Hall is a proper home with a roof that does not leak and a footman? Now that they can live as they like and do as they like, for the most part? Mr. Duncan makes a sound like a kettle about to boil.
I hope you pay little attention to the scurrilous libels in the London newspapers, Miss Payne. Certainly there are women who amuse themselves with sapphic romances, but there is no true carnality in play-acting. It's a physiological impossibility, you see. Isn't it, Dr. Jenner?
Dr. Jenner taps his teacup with his fingernail.
I am afraid most of my study of reproduction has to do with hedgehogs, sir. Ha! Says Duncan. Well, I'll leave it there. I see Mrs. Jenner is blushing. I forget I am not among my artistic friends.
Alice smiles at Catherine Jenner,
who is in fact visibly amused, and opens her mouth to change the subject. But Mr. Duncan has apparently not entirely tired of the sound of his own voice. He leans closer to Jane, so close that the razor bumps on his chin very nearly brush her perfect cheek, and he whispers something that makes the muscles just under Jane's eyes contract. Jane stands so abruptly that Duncan is thrown back, and Alice can tell from that exactly where his left hand was, the one that is not holding his glass. Alice sits back, interlaces her fingers, save for the two index fingers, which she holds to her lips. She gazes upon her beloved, thoughtfully, fiercely. Jane raises her teacup and says, "To the health of our hostess, Alice Payne." Alice's lips smile, and her eyes send Jane an eternal message, a cipher for which Jane will always hold the key. "Yes, to the mistress of Fleance Hall," says Miss Bell.
"My arse."
They turn, glasses foolishly in hand, to see Colonel John Payne standing in the doorway in his red silk banyan and brown cap. His eyes are red-rimmed, but he is not drunk. His gaze is clearer than she's seen it in years. But he's shrunken from pain and illness, and the suspicion that was once a mere canker on his character has now taken over his entire expression. Alice walks to him, puts a tentative hand on his arm.
"Father."
"You didn't want me at your party, Alice?"
"Your nurse said you were indisposed, sir."
"On the contrary, I feel very well indeed."
"That's the laudanum,"
she murmurs, but she turns to the company, puts her arm through her father's. He smells sour.
"My father, Colonel Payne."
The company bids him good evening.
"Will you take a brandy with us, sir?"
Duncan calls out. The colonel steps eagerly, obstinately out of Alice's arm and toward the table, but his legs are unsteady. He turns back, looks at Alice's face. She does not try to forbid him or chide him. What difference would it make? There was a time when the colonel was more cruel when in his cups, to please himself, but now he is cruel always, despite himself. Still, he nods slightly, as though she's said something. He glances down.
"I am tired," he says.
"Let me take you to your rooms, father,"
she says, softly, privately, but he shakes his head and turns again and walks out of the dining room, back the way he came. Satterthwaite, his loyal manservant, appears in the door like a specter. The party breaks up quickly, after the old ladies take snuff and Dr. Jenner engages Jane in some headlong discourse about yolk sacs. As they watch Ambrose Duncan don his great coat and walk through the hall, Alice says to Prudence, and particularly to Jane,
"You see, I told you he was a pig. I had an intuition, but I didn't expect him to show it that way. Are you all right, Jane?"
"I'm fine."
"Teach him a lesson, Alice," Prudence says. "Auden has my shimmer belt, but you can use the time wheel."
"Good," says Alice. "If only I had known, when I first became a knight of the road, that it was possible to be in two places at once."
She checks the watch on the chain at her belt. "It's just a few minutes past 9 o'clock now. I'll arrive at 10 past on the hill. It'll be sure to catch him, and there would be no way I could have reached there first. I mean, in the absence of a time wheel." Jane nods.
"As you like."
"You don't seem eager, beloved. And you had to sit next to the ass and his wandering hands all evening.
I'm sorry about that, dear.
If I'd known just how..."
"I only wonder what the point of it is. Yes, he'll have a fright and lose some money. No one will know that we're the ones who did it or why he deserved it."
"We'll know," Alice protests. She waves her hand at the far end of the hall, where the doors open from Fleance Hall out into the world. "There is no justice out there. But here, in this house..." She points her finger at the polished floor. "In this house, there will be justice." Jane nods, but she says softly,
"It seems a very small measure of justice for such a large house."
Chapter 2. One Woman Too Many. 1789. Alice has so little faith in Ambrose Duncan's character that she is wearing her breeches under her petticoats. Once the gown comes off, the coat goes on, and the cocked hat and black mask. Around her mouth, her green kerchief, torn and speckled with the stains of her own blood, her pistols at her waist, she goes out to saddle Havoc. And with that, Alice Payne becomes the Holy Ghost, the most feared highwayman in Hampshire. The first time Alice used Prudence's time travel device.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.